The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. We accept time as we know it. The sun in the morning, the moon at night, so many days, so many hours, minutes, seconds, all going forward, while you and I and everyone we know goes backwards. At least we're getting older, which is kind of not keeping up with time. Supposing it were possible to repeat life, not reincarnation, but repeating yourself in another era and beginning all over again. That is the premise of today's story on Mystery Theater.
Jake, this is 1880. You come from the year 1980. By means of the time box, you made 100 years trip backwards. So you know already what I cannot know yet.
And you suspect your daughter Priscilla is in love with a criminal?
I want to know what's in store for her. You can find out what I'll never know until it's too late.
Well, this man she's in love with, what crime do you think he's going to be accused of?
I believe he's going to murder Priscilla.
Our mystery drama, The Time Box, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by G. Frederick Lewis and stars Russell Horton.
I'll be back shortly with Act One.
We're in the town of North Orange. It's not as well known as East Orange or South Orange, but it's got good schools, clean streets, fair taxes, garbage picked up on time, mail delivered regularly. And it even puts out its own newspaper. One of the favorite columns is the Orange Box, written 6 days a week by Jake Howard, who right now just happens to be winding up the weekend words.
So, let me remind you, dear readers, the present is built on the past. Dig down a few feet anywhere on this earth, and there lies the remains of a previous civilization, of a previous century. Before North Orange had cars, cabs, and buses, we had trolleys. And before that, horse cars. Today, up on Main and Third, they're digging out the foundation for a big shopping mall. I'm hoping in that big hole to find a clue to a 100-year-old mystery. Tell you about it in my next column. So be sure to open up your Orange Box Monday morning. Yours, Jake Howard.
You're kidding me, aren't you, Mr. Howard?
What?
I said you're kidding.
I can't hear you.
Wait till I put her into neutral.
Big dipper shovels make so much racket, you never get used to it.
Mac, it just might happen I'll spot something which will clue me into a story I'm writing.
You mean I might dig up a treasure or something?
Might. You know what used to stand here on the corner of Main and Third about 100 years ago?
Fort Knox?
Yeah, something better, possibly. Right here was the laboratory of one of the greatest unsung inventors of the 1800s.
Oh, Edison? No, no, don't tell me. Alexander Graham Bell?
Nope. Dryden Harper.
Oh?
Dryden Harper. On this very spot, the trolley ran right past his door.
So, who was this Dryden Harper?
Well, in my book, and I've done a lot of research on this, he was just as great an inventor as any of them.
What'd he invent?
Well, something more important than the electric light, the phonograph, or the telephone. But all we have to go on are his notes. Nothing patented, no material clues.
So how come nobody ever heard of him?
Well, they will when I'm through. I'm going to write 6 whole columns, a whole week about Dryden Harper. And right here, where you're digging, Matt, is where the story begins.
Well, where'd you find out about this guy?
A reporter never reveals his sources. Okay, you can start up your shovel again.
See that truck pulling in? Got to fill her up fast to make up for lost time. All right, here comes the first load. Watch it.
Hey, hold it. Hold it. Don't let that truck move off.
He's going nowhere. I've got to give him 5 more bucketfuls.
Put your steam shovel in neutral and come with me, Mac. Let's climb into that truck. There's something there I want to see.
What are you looking for, Mr. Howard?
I think it's right under here. I saw it fall off your shovel right about here. Now, if you can just push all this junk to one side. Yeah. There she is.
Is that what you had me stop working for? An old black wooden box?
Easy. Let me lift it up. Funny looking, isn't it? Hinges on this side, a lock on that.
Small box. I mean, it's not big. Is it heavy?
20 pounds, I'd say. I wouldn't like to get hit with it. Wonder if this belonged to him. Looks old enough.
Mr. Howard, do you mind? Take the box and let's get off the truck. 2 other trucks are lining up over there. I gotta get going.
Crazy, this old box. Well made. Hey, you see those 2 holes drilled into the top about 2 inches apart? You haven't got a screwdriver on you, Mac. I'd like to see what's inside this. Maybe I can pry it open with my fingernails.
Oh, thank you, sir, indeed. Thank you so much.
Oh, I saw you getting off the trolley and then stumble and... Then there was all this smoke. I couldn't just stand there and not help a lady. Are you all right?
Yes, I think so. It was stupid of me to have fallen like that, wasn't it? I take this trolley every single day in both directions. Oh, I hope I didn't break anything in this box. My father would be extremely upset.
Well, may I carry the box for you? Is it heavy?
Yes, it is, sort of. I think that's how I lost my balance, getting off the trolley.
It's funny, I could swear...
Oh, please don't.
I don't know if I'm dreaming or not, but I've seen a wooden box very much like it. But where, I can't remember.
I do appreciate you helping me to my feet, sir. However...
However what?
Oh, I doubt very much you've ever seen this box before.
Oh, just a feeling I have. I could be wrong.
Nor have I ever seen you before, sir.
Oh, sorry. My name's Jake Howard.
How do you do, Mr. Howard? My name is Priscilla Harper.
Harper? Look, I know it's a very long shot, but do you happen to be related to Dryden Harper?
Why, yes. Yes, I am. I'm his daughter.
Dryden Harper's daughter? The Dryden Harper, the distinguished inventor, scientist, discoverer who was born in 1831?
Mr. Howard, for a stranger, you know a great deal about my father.
But you're so young. This is the town of North Orange, isn't it?
Oh, yes. But I've never seen you in town before. And I can see by your dress you're not a native.
Miss Harper, could we sit for a moment on this bench? I believe I'm dreaming.
Oh, dear me. That is one of the most ancient and oft-used bits of flattery in the entire lexicon.
It is?
And I shall be glad to sit on this bench for a moment. I need to catch my breath before I go in.
Now,
You are Dryden Harper's daughter, and you are sitting here dressed in,
perfectly ordinary street clothes.
Yes, you're sitting here, and I'm sitting here.
Are you quite well, Mr. Howard?
Amazing. Oh, excuse me. You were saying you travel on this trolley car, and,
Well, I'm coming home now, actually. My father had asked me to bring this box to a fellow scientist at the other end of town. So I went, but when I got there, he wasn't home. You know, I've wasted my entire morning.
But wouldn't it... I mean, why didn't you phone him in advance to make sure he was home?
Phone him?
What year is this?
1880, of course. What a silly question. Isn't it 1880 where you come from, Mr. Howard? What did you mean about phone him?
What I meant was if you had telephoned, but then I realized, hey, 1880, there wasn't, you don't have...
The telephone. My father is very well acquainted with Mr. Bell.
Uh-huh.
In fact, Dad visited him in Boston 4 years ago when Mr. Bell first demonstrated his telephone.
Could you, would you introduce me to your father? You know, I've read a great deal about him. In fact, as much as I could find. And to think I actually might be in a position to meet the gentleman, well, words fail me.
Mr. Howard, you happen to be right across the street from my father's house and laboratory. The trolley runs right past our corner. Certainly you may meet him.
Before I go in with you, may I have just one look at that wooden box you're carrying?
Sure, here, you may look at it.
So that's what those two holes were. Of course, two dials.
Mr. Howard, you're not trying to make me believe you've ever seen this box before.
Miss Harper, had I not ever seen that box, I would not be standing here with you at this very moment.
Mr. Howard, what you tell me about your trip through time pleases me enormously, but does not surprise me.
Mr. Harper, if you knew how excited I am to be actually in your house listening to you face to face, I don't know how to say it any better.
Well, thank you. It was my time box you found up there in 1980. Pretty bashed about, I gather, but still active.
Well, now, what about Bell and Edison? They haven't written anything about you.
We have to know Tom Edison and Alex Bell. You might say there's a professional rivalry between us, so I'm not surprised they didn't mention my name. Of course, neither of them have any idea about my time box.
Oh, well, if I get to meet them, you may be sure I won't say a word either.
You find my time box 100 years into the future, and it manages to convey you to our century. As I said, mum's the word about that.
May I ask, Mr. Howard, now that you're here, what do you intend to do?
Well, Mrs. Harper, I haven't given it a moment's thought. Fortunately, I'm a single man, no wife, no family. An orphan, in fact, so my disappearing from my own century at the corner of 3rd and Main isn't going to worry too many people.
It occurs to me, Priscilla, perhaps this young man from 100 years yet to come might help us.
How?
Along the lines we were discussing last night.
Dad, I wish you'd just stop using the time box for that stupid experiment. It isn't going to do you any good. I'm not ever going to stop seeing Hans. I don't care if you materialize Socrates or Shakespeare to come here and argue with me. Nobody and nothing in the world is going to put a stop to my friendship with Hans.
Priscilla, you know what has been happening here in North Orange the past 4 months? I couldn't bear to think my own daughter could come to the same fate.
Nothing's going to happen to me. Your suspicions are ridiculous.
My own daughter may be next. Mr. Howard, I'd like you to stay for dinner. There's something I would very much like to discuss with you.
Oh, Dad, why can't you be reasonable about this? There is nothing, absolutely nothing, to connect the man I love with the deaths of all those girls.
Quite a situation we have here. A scientist who wishes to prevent a tragedy of love and marriage
by consulting an eyewitness of the future. I've often thought how many missteps would I myself have avoided had I but known what would be ahead of time. On second thought, perhaps I'd rather take my chances and not know the unknown. I shall return shortly with Act Two. Howard's daily column called The Orange Box will suddenly stop appearing in 1980 because, unwittingly, he has found himself in the same town, his hometown, on the same street corner, 100 years earlier. Where a hole was being excavated, now stands a house. And in it lives a little-known scientific genius, one Dryden Harper and his daughter, Patricia. Supposing someone from the year 2080 suddenly appeared on your doorstep. There's a great deal you'd like to know also, isn't there?
Mr. Howard, I must talk to you. Would you stay to dinner?
Oh, I couldn't. I just couldn't. All I wanted to do was to meet you and chew the fat, you know, find out what makes you tick, you know?
Chew the fat?
There isn't much on record about you except your notes, which I found in the Library of Congress.
To a scientist, what a boon to meet a man from the future. Priscilla, can we forget our differences for now? There's still time to do the necessary marketing for dinner. Well, my daughter, sir, is an excellent cook, a quality she inherited from her mother, God rest her soul.
But we don't know the first thing about Mr. Howard, Dad.
Miss Harper, my interest in your father is quite genuine.
Priscilla, how can you doubt Mr. Howard's veracity? Do you think my time box didn't work? Have you ever seen clothing like he's wearing? What are those blue cloth trousers, anyway?
Oh, blue jeans.
Blue jeans. I never. Priscilla, who have you heard talking about a steam shovel, chewing fat? What else? Oh, yes. What makes me tick? I tell you this, daughter. If Jake here is a charlatan and pretending to have come from 100 years away, so be it. At least I'll enjoy his performance. Have a bit more sherry, my boy.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Harper.
So, you're a reporter on a newspaper right here in North Orange.
But the paper wasn't founded until 1900.
Oh, 20 years from now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm a columnist.
You do a lot of research, eh?
Well, that's how I ran across all your accomplishments.
Well, don't tell me about them before I do them. I may be disappointed. How good are your town records, the history of North Orange, that kind of thing?
Pretty complete. We've got records of people who lived here since 1790. That's what my newspaper column's all about, the history of the town.
What's that time? 5, 6? I lost count.
5.
Oh, good. We've at least a half hour before Priscilla gets back. Jake, let me pull my chair closer to you. Because what I'm about to tell you is confidential.
Well, go ahead, Dryden.
In all your researches about our town up there in 1980, did you ever run across the name Dr. Hans Flexner?
Dr. Hans Flexner. Oh, is that the Hans your daughter is interested in?
Yes. She thinks she's in love with him.
Well, why would there be any record of him in 1980? Is he about to make some extraordinary medical discovery? Would he be in the almanac?
I don't know. What I do know is, this is hard for me to say, what I want to know is, was a Dr. Flexner ever arrested for any crime?
You mean you suspect Priscilla is in love with a criminal?
Was he ever arrested? Will he be arrested? I want to know the future now, Jake. You've come from there. Only you can help me. In the past 4 months, 10 young ladies have been stabbed to death. By the time the police arrive, there isn't a clue left. The poor girls have been sliced up as though by some insane doctor, a surgeon, or even a dentist.
And there's evidence a surgical instrument was used?
Expertly, in each case. What's more, it appears that each victim was unconscious before she was murdered. You follow that? They're not sure, but they think a newly discovered anesthetic was used. Ether.
Yes, to knock them out first.
What? Oh, well, but it could also have been chloroform. That's why I say the murderer could also be a dentist.
And what's that got to do with Dr. Hans Flexner?
Hans Flexner is a dentist.
Dad, Dad, I'm back. Sorry it took so long. Dinner will be ready in about an hour.
Sir, I don't think you can pin this rap on Flexner without more to go on. Now, did they find any of the murder weapons?
Yes, one. A surgeon's scalpel.
Nothing identifying on the scalpel, I suppose.
How could there be?
Hopeless. Well, if you don't catch the murderer in the act, I don't think you people have much of a chance. It's unsolvable.
That's how you happened to be here tonight, Jake.
How come?
I was using my time box to help me be a detective. Something went wrong with the timing, and here you are. Do you have a place to live in while you're visiting this sanctuary?
Well, no, I haven't.
Then you'll sleep here. After all, I'm responsible for the whole thing.
Dad is so funny, but I expect you're finding that out.
Miss Harper...
Priscilla. If Dad calls you Jake all through dinner and insists you call him Dryden, I'm not going to be left out.
Okay, sure. Do you still think I'm some actor playing the part of a time voyager?
Oh, I suppose not. Mainly because I know the power of the time box. Has he said much to you about Hans?
Dr. Flexner?
Well, I can see he has. Dad's got this fixed idea that Hans has been killing young girls and one day he'll do away with me. If you met Hans, you'll see right away what a silly idea it is. So to satisfy himself, Dad set his time box for 1830, 50 years ago, so he could materialize that great hypnotist, Franz Mesmer.
Is that true? The time box can pick people out if you want it to?
Well, certainly. I can't begin to tell you how many celebrities have shown up here on our doorstep from centuries back. But you're the first person to arrive from the future.
So the date settings on the box are not always accurate.
No, that hasn't been perfected. That was the scientist I was going to see this morning when you turned up at the trolley. He's blind, but Dad thought he could help perfect the directional dial.
Uh-huh. And why did he want to materialize Mesmer?
He was going to deceive Hans. Pass off Mesmer as an old friend from Germany who needed a tooth extracted. And while he was in the chair, he was supposed to mesmerize Hans.
To get him to admit under hypnosis he was the mass murderer.
Exactly. Stupid, isn't it?
You know what? You're getting to sound just like you lived in my day.
Hans, I'm so glad to be with you at last.
I hear you have a visitor at your house, Liebchen.
A friend of Dad's. Mm.
Who is he, an inventor?
Oh, no, he's a newspaper man.
I see. How is your tooth?
Oh, it still hurts where you looked at it the day before yesterday.
All right. We shall have another look.
Isn't it maddening? I used to tell Dad my teeth hurt and I would have to have them taken care of, which was all a pretense so I could come and see you. And now it's really hurting. It's as if I was being punished for lying.
Get into the chair, Liebchen. We'll see what is the matter. There.
Beide.
Yeah. I think that wisdom tooth should come out. Do you mind?
Will the pain stop?
Oh, immediately.
Oh, darling Hans, I trust you implicitly.
Since the removal could be painful, suppose I give you something to make you fall asleep. It will take me half an hour or so to prepare what I must do.
You may not believe this, Dryden. I've never ridden in a horse-drawn trolley in my life. Or any kind of trolley.
That is so? Is there no public transportation in the 1980s?
Oh, yes, but it's buses or taxis, you know.
I've stopped trying to understand your vocabulary.
Oh, no, wait, I take that back. I have been on a trolley. When I was in San Francisco, I took the cable car. That's an electric trolley that's pulled uphill by a cable that moves underground.
That's extraordinary. Did you say electric?
Oh, yeah, electric power is used everywhere. Now we've even got nuclear power.
Please.
Oh, you'll be having electricity pretty soon. Commercially.
That's what Benjamin Franklin drew from lightning down a silk kite string into a Leyden jar, yes?
Yes, but this kind will be man-made. Now, George Westinghouse is making some dynamos in about 5 years. Yeah, 1885.
I'll watch for them.
Is it far to the police station?
No, we're almost there. The Bureau of Licenses is next door to it. I must say, Jake, you go about investigating Hans Flexner in a most professional way.
Years in the newspaper business. The information I want seldom comes to me. I have to go to it.
Well, we're here. Where do we go first?
To the police. Now, Dryden, don't be nervous. Mm. Don't borrow trouble. Just hang in there.
Would you translate for me, please?
Keep cool.
Well, if that means I shouldn't get hot and worry unduly, I'll try not to.
Hans, darling, why does it take so long for you to prepare that sleeping powder or whatever it is?
Well, it's all done. I should give you something very new, Liebchen. Much better than the nitrous oxide those old-fashioned dentists use. Now, close your eyes.
What are you going to give me to put me to sleep?
It is called chloroform. Very effective. Now, I'll just hold this cloth over your nose, lie back, and breathe. What the devil is that?
There's someone at the door. I thought you told me you didn't have any patients today.
Open up! You hear me, Flexner? I know you're in there.
Oh, my heavens! It's Jake!
Go away, whoever you are. I'm busy.
Priscilla! Are you all right?
Jake, what are you doing here?
How dare you break into my office? Nobody comes in here without an appointment. Look what you did to the door.
Come on, Priscilla.
I shall go and inform the police at once.
Yes, why don't you do that, Flexner? Tell them also where you got your degree in dental surgery. There doesn't seem to be any record of it.
Jake, what are you saying?
Tell them also you use chloroform on your patients. I can smell it clear out into the hall.
Jake, have you gone crazy?
Chloroform! The whole dental profession uses ether, not nearly as dangerous. Priscilla, get up out of that chair. You are coming with me.
Yes, it wasn't until Queen Victoria was given chloroform upon the birth of Prince Leopold that it became the accepted anesthetic. She tells us in her journal, "Dr. Snow gave me that blessed chloroform, and the effect was soothing, quieting, and delightful beyond measure." Somehow, I have the idea that Dr. Hans Flexner was not intending merely to soothe and quiet his patient. Perhaps I'm mistaken. I shall return shortly with Act Three. This is not an easy story to preface, comment on, or conclude. Once you meddle with time, it's difficult to apply the rules we live by today. Jake's yesterday is not Priscilla's. Priscilla's tomorrow may not be Jake's. One factor, however, could overcome the 100 years that separated these two. Love. Yes, love. Unfortunately, right now, that is the furthest emotion from Priscilla's mind.
How dare you break into the private office of a dear friend of mine and threaten him with such a display of ungentlemanliness? I don't know how I can ever face Hans again. Dad, you have no idea how embarrassing this 1980 man was.
Now, hold on, Priscilla. Now, first of all, your dear friend isn't even a licensed dentist.
At the Hall of Records, Priscilla, the name Hans Flexner doesn't appear on the Dental Association's list.
I won't have you two spying on me and my friends. I won't have it.
And I won't have a daughter of mine screaming like a fishwife. Go to your room.
So he doesn't have a license to practice dentistry here in North Orange. How do you know he didn't get his license abroad?
We don't know.
Dad, if you'd like to know the truth, my tooth has been getting very painful. I saw Hans several times, but it keeps getting worse. He was just about to pull it when Jake charged in like a bull.
What? Is that really true? Not like all those other times?
On my honor, it's killing me.
Well, then, of course, we'll have it looked at. First thing in the morning. But I'll choose the dentist, and I'll go with you.
All right, I agree. You choose the dentist. It's too painful for me to refuse.
Nurse? Excuse me, am I in the right place?
That depends. Do you wish to see the doctor for an extraction or a fill-in?
My name is Jake Howard. I'm visiting with Dryden Harper and his daughter. I took an early morning stroll, and when I returned, they left me a note. They'd gone to this office. Miss Harper had an appointment. Are they still here?
Oh, you're Mr. Howard. They left word to tell you everything's all right. They've been and gone half an hour ago.
The doctor was able to locate the pain? The tooth, I mean?
Well, there was nothing wrong with the tooth. What had been causing the discomfort was a small piece of cohesive gold foil we use in fillings. It was lodged under the gum.
Wait, I don't understand. Miss Harper isn't in the habit of eating gold foil.
You know, the doctor thought it was mysterious, too, since Miss Harper doesn't have a single filling. It was placed under the gum quite firmly. Ah, the poor child. It must have been very, very painful.
Hand me those tongs next to you, will you, Jake?
Thanks for inviting me to your lab, Dryden. It's a handy little furnace you have there.
Well, it's my little hell and my little heaven.
What are you going to put in the furnace?
The secret of what powers the time box.
You're going to tell me?
Well, I feel I owe it to you, Jake. And if you're writing about how I experiment, this is crucial.
Oh, you don't owe me anything.
On the way home from the dentist, Priscilla wouldn't say a word. But when you told her to ask herself why would her great love, Hans, wish to hurt her, I think she began to see him differently. So, I have you to thank.
Well, I wish... Never mind.
Tell me.
She's a lovely girl. I wish I didn't have to go back to my century, that's all. You see... Now, what are you going to do with the tongs?
Under this bell jar, what do you see?
Looks like particles of stone.
Small pieces of a meteorite. I lift the bell jar, take up one small particle with the tongs, open the furnace door, and place the piece of meteorite in the crucible inside the furnace. Close the door, turn my hourglass upside down, and wait.
I'll be darned.
Ah, that hasn't dawned on the scientists of the 1980s, eh?
No. To my knowledge, no one's thought of releasing the energy stored in meteorites. By the way, where's Priscilla?
She'll be here when she's washed the dinner dishes. Whenever I have a special problem, she helps me here at night.
Still problems?
Only one. The directional dial. The time dial works very well, barring an accident, as in your case. But to materialize someone across space, that directional finder must be made accurate.
Good evening, gentlemen. Shall we tackle the problem?
Priscilla, we were all just having dinner together. Why so formal?
Say, I have an idea. Is there a place in town where I can get some ice cream at night?
Iced cream? Oh, I'd love it.
Is it popular in the 1980s?
Is it? So, where do I go?
Well, you're at 3rd and Main now. Just one block down to 4th, you're at Mama Kelly's. She's open till 10, and she's got ice cream.
Mm-hmm. You both go for vanilla?
We sure do.
Well, I'll be back as soon as I can.
I'm glad you're being a little nicer to Jake, Priscilla.
It's not hard. I suppose one of these days he'll be wanting to get back to his century.
I'm charging up the time box to full strength for his trip.
Oh, so you think he'll go back, too?
Well, he could stay in 1880, grow old here. Be smart enough to get work. Mm. Imagine if he stayed and used his knowledge of the next 100 years. He'd be invaluable. He could be president of this country for a lifetime.
Dad, there's somebody outside the laboratory.
What? Where?
I just saw a face at the window, and then it went away.
Oh, some nosy Parker. I'll go out and see who it is.
No, don't, please.
Well, what's there to be afraid of? All right. Hand me that poker from the furnace. Keep an eye on the temperature gauge. Lower the gas if it gets too high. Mm-hmm. I'll go out and scare away whoever it is.
Well, here we are. Mama Kelly's best. One vanilla for you, one for me, and one for your... Triden, where is he?
He just went out. We thought there was a prowler.
A prowler in this day and age? Next thing you'll tell me there are muggers. Yeah, let's go out and find him. I'll leave his ice cream here. We ought to be able to see Dryden easily enough. It's a fine moon.
Jake, why don't we just stand here and enjoy it?
Hmm.
Dad'll walk all the way around the block and come right back. Jake, I apologize.
Oh, don't. Girls in love. You can't reason with them.
No, I don't think I was. That's the funny part about it. When everything came out about Hans, I think I was sort of relieved. Maybe I was in love with love.
Hey, look. Hey, you, come back here. There's somebody running over there. I'm going to follow him here. Now, take my ice cream. Now, go back into the lab and lock the door. Go on. I think I lost him. I thought they'd invented streetlights by now. Which way did he go? Ow! Darn, why did I fall over? There's someone on the ground. Dryden! Holy mackerel! He's been chloroformed. Hello, Priscilla.
Oh, you scared me, Hans.
Since when do I frighten you, Liebchen?
How did you get into the laboratory? What are you doing with that knife?
You haven't been to see me in a long time. Don't you like me anymore?
Hans, I was with you yesterday.
I think something must be done about that tooth. See, I've brought this cloth with me. Now put it over your face, and you take a deep breath, and all will be over.
Oh, I can smell it from over here.
You don't like me anymore, do you?
Not when you behave this way.
They all turn on me in the end. They want your friendship, your pretty words. They like the presents you give them, and then suddenly it's all over.
Who are they, Hans?
All of them. All of them. You're just like all of them.
So, when you believe they are turning against you, Hans, what do you do?
I don't let them do that. They never reject me. I don't let them reject me.
So, it is true. It's all true. Jake was right.
Who was right?
I was right, Flexner. Get away from her. Priscilla, duck!
No, Jake, don't! Don't throw it!
Priscilla?
Jake, are you still here?
Yeah, I am. Wait till the smoke clears. You'll see for yourself.
Oh, I see you now. Oh, Jake. When I saw you lift up the time box, I was afraid I'd never see you again.
It was the only thing handy to throw at him.
Hans? Where is he?
I saw the box hit him on the shoulder just before there was that big bang. He's nowhere, Priscilla. Or the time box.
That's gone, too?
Not a trace. Now we have no idea which century is getting a present of one Hans Flexner.
Or which country.
Well, who knows? He might be spinning in space forever.
What do I care about him? You're here, and you're safe. Oh, my gosh. I completely forgot. Did you find Dad?
Oh, yeah, I sure did. He'd been chloroformed. I brought him to and carried him up to his bedroom.
He seems okay.
He must have heard the explosion. He'll be wondering what it's all about.
The door to the lab was open, Dryden, and there was Flexner with a scalpel in his hand.
Dad, he was pointing it right at my throat. But Jake, he stopped him.
Oh, well, I threw the time box at him. Aimed at it, his head hit him in the shoulder. Not a very good shot.
But it worked. There was a flash. Didn't you hear the sound, Dad? A big flash, and Hans disappeared.
And the time box?
Oh, it went with him. No question, he wanted to destroy Priscilla. Oh, now, how do you feel, Dryden?
Well, except for this terrible taste in my mouth. All right.
I'm sorry about the time box. There went my ticket to tomorrow. I guess I'll just have to hang around here.
That's right, Jake. You've no way of getting back to 1980 now.
Did you shut down the furnace, Priscilla?
Oh, no. I'll go take care of it.
I'm going to need those meteorite chips for the next time box I build.
You're going to build another one right away, Dad?
I was thinking, Dryden, I'm in no rush to get back to my job. The column can wait.
Well, don't you concern yourself, Jake. I can build an even better and more accurate time box. It would take time, but I could.
Oh, Dad.
I tell you, Dryden, there's no hurry. I've no reason to go at all. 1880 sort of, suits me.
It would appear that anything can happen when you mess about with time. Here today, gone tomorrow. A pleasure, certainly, if you're able to go back, as did Jake Howard. But supposing one went too far forward in time, it might be pretty bleak and lonely up there in exploded space. I'll be back shortly. Benjamin Franklin, who used his years probably better than any other American before or since, used to say, "If time be of all things the most precious, wasting time must be the greatest extravagance, since lost time is never found again. Let us then be up and doing to the purpose." Which isn't bad advice, is it? Even though I had to go back in time 200 years to get it. Our cast included Russell Horton, Diana Kirkwood, and Robert Dryden. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown.
And now, a preview of our next tale.
I will be with you when you least look to see me. I will come to you when your life seems brightest.
Oh, Andre.
I will come between you and all you hold fairest and dearest. My ghostly hand shall drop a poison in your cup of joy. My shadowy form shall shut the sunlight from your life. Men with such iron will as mine can do what they please, Hector de Boissac. It is my will to haunt you when I am dead.
This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.